so our next speaker is Kostas Daniilidis from the University of Pennsylvania. He's a group slalom professor, I believe, at the University of Pennsylvania. He's been the previous director of the grasp lab. He's done some really cool work on essentially geometry and computer vision at the intersection of computer vision and machine learning. And more recently, he's been doing a lot of work on structured deep models, trying to essentially bring in constraints and priors from geometry into these deep networks. And that's sort of what he's going to be talking about today, on building equivariant networks.
Right. Thank you very much, Aaron. This is really a great and very inspiring workshop. Talk about work from my student Carlos, my student Christine, and my ex-student Mish Makadia, who is now at Google. So we have a lot of manipulation efforts at Penn, and I'm usually to the perception part. And recently, the way to do that is really you have off-the-shelf detectors, which you see on the left. And we have an approach which was presented at ICRA 17, where we detect this what we call semantic key points, which are really shared across a class of objects. And based on these semantic key points, we can reconstruct, we can interpolate the shape of the object if this particular shape has not been seen. And then we fit also a rotation and translation. And as a result of this, you can estimate grasp positions in doing pretty much this in two steps, a perception purely with learning and the grasping with an old-fashioned approach. But still, what was bothering me with the perception part was really that with all these experiments, we had to demonstrate the objects in all possible angles, whether lying on the table or around their axis. And this really bothered me because my whole life I was looking for minimal problems in geometry. Our three-point algorithm, just 3 points, is running on the AR core at Google right now, if you have your Pixel phone running. And this really enumeration or even randomization of viewpoints and rotation was really bothering me. So the main message of this talk is really that you can find some structure to put into your network in order to minimize data augmentation, which many of you say it is free because you do it in simulations, but intellectually for me it is not free. Okay. And the number of weights and parameters in the network.
Closure, okay.
So the main, the most common term for this is really invariant, like viewpoint invariant. But before invariant, what we really want is equivariance. And starting from the basics, equivariance is really the fact that if you translate your origin, like this human there, then you can predict where your features will lie at the layers of your neural network. And convolutional networks, by default, are translation equivariant. So this is really because of the definition of the convolution. And invariance comes by just choosing the maximum in one of these layers. If it is the maximum across pixels, then you preserve invariance. And many times invariance is confused with equivariance. For example, shift means a scale invariant feature transfer, but it is actually equivariant. You construct the whole scale space and you choose the maximum, and the maximum gives you the scale invariance. But if you try to do that with rotations, you will realize that your common CNN is not really rotation equivariant. As a matter of fact, you can really play just with the filter from the first layers of AlexNet, or with your handcrafted Gabor or first derivative. And you will see that in order order to actually get the rotated version of the features when the input is rotated, you really have also to rotate your filter. By default, if you rotate your input X, the output X convolved with F is not rotated. If you apply also rotations in all the filters, then you can get the same result. And you can do it experimentally. You can do it also as a homework in our class. So why do you want equivariance? You want equivariance because you know that, for example, shift is very useful. And if you construct equivariance, as I said, with just a max or average pooling, you can achieve invariance. Stefan Malat has averaged the magnitudes of the responses in order to do the pooling. He has shown in scattering networks that you can achieve scaling and rotation invariance. But most important, you don't have to do all this data augmentation. Take all these digits and objects and start rotating for your input or in your Unity engine, doing all possible rotations. And of course, if you have fewer data, you can also decrease the capacity of the network and use much fewer weights and also have a much faster play. And in robotics, except maybe a few approaches which are viewpoint invariant. You have seen many approaches in this RSS where there is a static camera and observes a manipulator in the toy world. And if you change the position of the camera, this doesn't work anymore. This is what we really want to avoid it in a robotics task. So there has been recently several approaches which are really very, very interesting, starting from Gabriel Grosto's approach with the harmonic networks. Really just with a very simple realization that if you write a filter in polar coordinates, then every rotation results just in the complex harmonic multiplication. And the way to put the structure in the networks is really to write the exponential harmonic explicitly into TensorFlow and keep your networks in a radial form like this. And then you achieve with having actually this masks applied locally, you achieve not only rotational but also translational equivariance. And this is probably the most efficient approach right now to achieve local scaling and rotation invariance. Coming from a more general group theoretic background, which are all the approaches by Max Wedding's group, where the idea is that in order to get a convolution realized in a group, you can produce rotated copies. So, and if you produce rotated copies, the only way to do it exactly, you have a discretized signal, like an image, is really on the 90 degrees and reflections and translations. Otherwise, you have to interpolate, you get only approximate equivariance. And you produce all these copies. This has been done also by Dilleman in, where is it? This is done also by Dilleman from Google and many actually astronomers to produce rotation invariant detection of structures in the sky. And this produces a quite significant network because you have to produce all these copies of rotations. Alternatively, something that all of you might have heard is the special transformer network from Gederberg and Andrew Zisserman at DeepMind, where you compute what is a transformation with a regression network, and then you take the actual values, for example, an affine transform or a rotation, and you can transform your input into a canonical representation, and then you apply a classification or motion or depth estimation task in the warped network. This is really orthogonal to building something which is equivariant and where just the maximum operation, the arg max, gives you the actual parameters instead of having a full regression to estimate the parameters. Now recently you see, you might have seen a CVPR actually, it's a very interesting approach, not enumerating actually viewpoints, but really randomizing and having a recurrent network that really recurs over the from Sergey and my ex-student Alex Toshev, and this is really the most promising viewpoint invariant work I have seen in a visual, in a real robotic visual servoid task. But still, actually, the number of random trials of viewpoints you have to enumerate is quite significant. So how do we deal first, a very small, short glimpse, how to deal with 2D scale and rotational invariance without sacrificing the traditional translational invariance from the convolutional networks? And the idea comes from really 30 years ago almost, from this is a paper from Technion in PAMI. And it comes from the idea that from very specific groups, which actually are commutative groups, you can find canonical coordinates which can transform your transformation to a translation. All of you might have heard of the polar coordinates, which convert a rotation into a shift. If you add the logarithm in the radius, you do the same for the scale. And you can see here in the MNIST data set that if actually the number 5 is increasing in size, then you have a shift to the right. If you rotate the number 5, then you have a shift on the left. But the problem is that you have to choose an origin in order to build that. And for that, we combine the idea of the spatial transformer with the canonical coordinates. So in the first part of the network, we estimate what is the centroid. And this is something that is really much simpler than a spatial transformer. It is really just, you could apply it also a bounding box. Any of the RCNN approaches, any of the region CNN approaches to compute that. Then you shift your image and then you apply your coordinates and you have a full scaling and rotational in equivariant network in 2D, which transforms the features in this way. So if the 3 becomes larger, then the features are translated to the right. If the 3 is rotating, then the features are translated up or down. And this is really very simple. I mean, this is really quite straight forward. But the main challenge is in 3D, because in 3D we have not even agreed on what representation to use. In images, everybody uses pixels, but in 3D you can use multiple views. You can use voxels. You can use just a set of XYZ point clouds, or you can use a full, like a watertight mesh. And 3D rotations, everybody who has worked with 3D object detection in RGBD or in point clouds, you might have realized that their 3D rotations are really much harder to handle with just data augmentation. So this is just to give you an idea how we process 3D data. This is one of the most successful approaches, the VoxNet, where you really do convolutions in the voxel space. Like you have like 3x3x3 masks and times the number of channels. And at the end, you get some translational equivariance. You might have a set of views of an object. This is from Hao Su. And then apply a CNN in each of the views. And then you apply view pooling. And this somehow has some rotational invariance in it based on the number of the viewpoint on the sphere because of the pooling. And then you have a point net where you operate directly on XYZ coordinates. And this is really a complete chaos because you just multiply the coordinates themselves. You don't even multiply pixels or voxels. And you have also approaches where you, in addition to the data augmentation, like rotating, you do the same on subvolumes. And if you apply something like a spatial transformer, which is here, you see that you can hardly improve, actually, your network if you apply a spatial transformer on subregions. of your network. And this figure is really what tells a lot. We have three kinds of approaches. One is which is trained only on augmentations around the z-axis, which is what you get if you are using just the bird data set or any of the data sets. They have many actually views which are just rotation around the vertical axis. Pretty much they have the object standing and not lying. And then it is with that augmentation in the full rotation and then corresponding in the testing. And you're going to see that the performance, if you really train only on the Z, it really is, the performance is really falling if you are testing on the full SOV. So we decided to attack really this problem, and the first is to find an appropriate representation so that you can apply rotations, and the natural representation to apply rotation, like the manifold where rotations are acting, is the sphere. So you can choose a spherical representation for your object. You can choose a center again with a special transformer, the way we do it with the local transform. And then you can build, for example, a spherical representation by just having a vector valued function with the radii where you are intersecting your mesh or your volumetric model. Alternatively, you can sample the view sphere the way that Hao Shu and others have done for the CNN, and you can have a descriptor for your two-dimensional shape at every point of the sphere. And this, we have done it about 10 years ago, and it was running very successfully in the 3D warehouse from Google with handcrafted features, not learned ones. Now, if you build this spherical input, you are you open a textbook and you see that you have two options, either to use convolution or correlation. And people these days with CNN, they don't even bother. I mean, your mask, who really remembers whether you have flipped it in order to do the convolution or not in translation? But in the sphere, this is not just a flip. The result of the convolution or the correlation changes. The convolution, as usually, is in the same domain as the input, so the result is on the sphere, while on the correlation, and most of the networks these days are really relation networks, even in 2D, the result of the correlation is on ISO 3. And you have, you integrate correspondingly, you marginalize over the sphere or over the rotation. Now, if we are able to find the convolution which is of the corresponding group, the way we have it in translation, and we denote this convolution with this star G, then we know by the definition of the convolution that this will be equivariant. So if we apply an action A in the input, this will be applied on the whole feature maps. Now, there is a small problem with when you try to implement this, that you cannot take just a theta phi sphere, unfold it, and just run a mask there, because if you are get a template and you try to run it on the mask, you will see that this is really a space variant operation. And if you see any paper, there are a few papers around who try to do that, they are really cheating in terms of implementing the convolution. So the only way to do it exactly is really in the Fourier domain. And we're not the first ones, even like some of the pioneers of CNNs have proposed actually spectral implementation even from the pure translational networks, and definitely you have heard about graph convolutions. It was a very common theme in CBPR. In graph convolution, the spectral approaches are very common as well. On the sphere, you don't have, I mean, if you, the sphere, the Fourier domain is just a basis of spherical harmonics, which look like this. And you have always two indices, the L index, which is the vertical one, and the M index, which goes from, which varies depending on the frequency. And there's a very nice tutorial by Misha Kasdan at Johns Hopkins about FFTs in graphics and vision in several other groups, not the manifolds. This has been first discovered as correlation, not a convolution, by Quine and Welling, who received for this work the best paper at ICLR 2 months ago. As opposed to them, what we do is really an exact convolution, not correlation. For the convolution, you have the effect that if you convolve in the original sphere with a filter H, you have a point-wise multiplication, but you only multiply with the DC component in one of the frequencies, this little zero you see by the H over there. And this really means that you take only actually the central components of every azimuthal frequency, which means you're averaging over the azimuth. And your filters actually are have fewer coefficients, fewer weights, and they are symmetric about the north pole. So we do the design in the filter in the frequency domain. We don't really define a mask, and this gives you a lot of freedom from using a lot of ideas from signal processing. The first is that if you design your filter in the frequency domain, you realize that in the actual sphere, you don't get any locality. Your features actually are looking like this. They cover the whole object. This is really against the idea of using a convolutional network, right? Convolutional network, the locality is one of the most significant properties. But you can enforce locality if you really guarantee that your spectrum is smooth. And there is a proof about this, that if you design your spectrum and the way we do it is we choose very few frequencies and we interpolate during testing and running time these frequencies, and then you guarantee that your filters look are very constrained. Now, just the convolutions are not providing for your CNN. The CNN needs a very good nonlinearity. The problem with the nonlinearity is that first, if we apply it in the regular domain, we have to go back. We have to provide an inverse for the other spot. And in addition, this would violate any band limit we have. By violating the band limit, we would having a not many, actually, not a very dense discretization of our sphere, we would violate the whole reconstruction theory. And for the nonlinearity, this is something new that we have proposed and we're applying actually in other domains as well. Whenever you have some property where the coefficients are rotated, like in the spherical harmonics, then we build as a nonlinearity a hidden layer, one hidden layer perceptron, which takes the magnitudes of these coefficients. This idea of building a perceptron for nonlinearity comes also from Stefan Malascu. And trying just to have this perceptron emulate just a multiplication of the original coefficients. And this guarantees that we preserve the band limit and the equivariance. So this is how a spherical CNN looks like. You take your mesh, you construct a spherical, a vector value representation, and you have a freedom how to construct this. Then you have these nine layers, and at the last layer we do a global weighted average. We construct just one descriptor for the whole object. So depending on band limits and how much nonlinearity we intersect, you can measure how much how exact is your equivariance in full rotations or just rotations about the z-axis. This is how the maps are actually used, are rotated when you rotate the original input. And it is important to say that we only use a 64 by 64 sphere. So it is really a pretty rough discretization of every radius which intersects the object. These are examples where you just test the shape alignment, how to really do what you would point cloud registration, or just the course alignment before you apply an ICP. These are how invariant the descriptors are, and you can see in the first that if you have just a Z rotation, and then you all the descriptors look the same. If you apply a full rotation, the equivariance is approximate, and this is really because of the discretization effects. And these are results, this is really the main message, the results of the rotated model net 40 data set. This is really one of the most challenging data sets, where when we say ZZ, it is on what it is something trained and on what it is something tested. And the most important number is that instead of using 99 million of parameters or 17 million of parameters, we are using only 500,000 weights in our network, and with a much smaller input size of 64 square plus two vector values for every point on the sphere. The only other thin network, the boxnet, does not even perform in any actually SO3 input because it does only translation convolutions in the voxel space. And these are results about some other shape retrieval contest where we have also quite competitive results with really orders of magnitude less coefficients. So this is, we have the full code for this approach. It's really, you can see that you can implement full transformation like Fourier transformations in TensorFlow and still everything stays differentiable. And this is in a completely different note. We are presenting a poster on learning sensory motor affordances with completely a supervised way in the poster session now this afternoon. And I think I'm done. Thank you. Yes.
Questions?
Yeah.
Yes.
This approach needs some segmentation. Now, obtaining a mask from segmentation, I think these days is a solved problem with mask calculation. Now, but still, with the mask, you only have one view. And you, unless you have trained your network with all the views, you cannot do anything because it is a detection problem. It's not really the content from behind might be completely different. So for this case, you definitely have to provide all the views, but you don't have to provide it from different viewpoints. So the viewpoints cover the occlusion, but as soon as you cover once the occlusion, you don't have to, for the same visible part, you don't have to rotate it. I mean, that's a very good question. Now, when the Fourier transform is a global operation, that's the second problem that the occlusion has, right? And this we have realized that if we take the sphere of a viewpoint of a view sphere, where you have a silhouette at every point, you don't have a radius representation, then you are up to your you can deal with up to 40% visible part. Just because there is a lot of information in the silhouettes themselves. In the radii, when you have this representation, you don't have much information.
Any other questions? Actually, I have a question about just equivariance. I know that there's a lot of work, recent work on equivariance. saying that there's now a lot of recent work on using equivariance to sort of be a loss function in some form so that you can try to learn better feature representations for your networks. Do you think this relates to that in some way, or is it used to do something like that?
So you can enforce in the loss function by producing additional even synthetic rotations. You can enforce that the result is the same, and this is really a very good idea. There is some freelance there. Usually with data augmentation or automation, there's no freelance. You put a lot of data, but there is freelance because the additional rotations are provided inside the network. They're not provided as there. So you will never say that in this approach, the size of the input is as big as in the approaches that any loss function which is geometric is really good. You are able to do a differential. Yes? So it will be updated with new instances or new like transformations? That is more related to the occlusion problem. I mean, this, if you really had a dome, like Yasser Saikir gave us a dome where you can see a lot of producible object, then by default, you need to only new instances of state. You don't see new views. Now, if you want new views like RGBD, or you have a constrained field of view, then again, in terms of computation, this is not a problem. But in terms of representation, it's better to use multiple views on the sphere instead of using the way I presented it with the point cloud intersecting the sphere. That's the main thing we have learned.
Great, let's thank the speaker.